are enjoying your meal. And I know some tables are still needing to be served, and we'll serve those really soon. Before I outline the rules, can you hear me at the back? You can't hear me at the back. Can you hear me now? Oh, excellent. Before I outline the rules of engagement, I would like to invite Ms. Janine Meiberg, the President of the Cape Chamber of Commerce and Industry, to say a few words. Janine.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, dignitaries, guests, and very importantly, our members. On behalf of the board and myself, I would like to welcome each and every one of you here this evening at our first of our quarterly events. Tonight, we have a proverbial battle of the heavyweights between the controversial, and I'm sure you'll agree with me, the one-of-a-kind MP, Mr. Julius Malema, and the and one of the best-informed futurists in South Africa, Mr. Clem Sunter. We will be taking part in a two-round debate. We organized tonight's event as we know both these gentlemen have very strong views on the future of South Africa and its faltering economy. I have no doubt, and I'm sure you will agree with me, that it will be an interesting and exciting to see these gentlemen exchange their views and insights. We chose these two gentlemen specifically as we are looking forward to a fair exchange of debating punches with a little ducking and diving as possible. The chamber organized the bout, the rumble in the urban jungle, as it is essential for business to come to terms with the future scenarios for our future and how it could affect both business opportunities and, very importantly, job creation. Too often, ladies and gentlemen, the lines in debate become confused as people seek to gain short-term advantages and audiences to support rather than a deeper look or gain the support of audiences rather than to look deeper and to the true meaning or the long-term consequences of the policies. Mr. Malema represents a different approach to our challenges, and it is important to understand his thinking and what he is aiming to achieve. Mr. Sunter, on the other hand, represents a more established view and has a vast knowledge of the economy and our problem industry, the mining industry. We are sure that he should mount an excellent defense to the issues raised by Mr. Malema. We have billed this as the rumble in the urban jungle, but we are looking for more information and understanding, ladies and gentlemen, rather than physical conflict. The blows we want to see tonight are the blows of telling arguments and counterpunches with different views. Ideally, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to see both combatants leave the ring with a clearer understanding of the other's views. This evening's two-round clash will be followed with a question and answer session, so you will have the opportunity to ask your various combatants questions. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, the aim for this evening is for us to end up being better informed of the various scenarios and with an improved appreciation of the forces at work in our economy in order to equip us as business to make better decisions about future projects and, more importantly, investments. The only thing that remains for me to say is, ladies and gentlemen, sit back and enjoy the evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Janine. The topic for this evening, as you may know, is South Africa's future, economic future, boom or bust. So let's get the rumble underway. This is how it will work. Mr. Sunter will speak for 20 minutes. Mr. Malema will then follow with another 20-minute slot. Thereafter, Mr. Sunter will counter for 5 minutes, and then Mr. Malema will follow with another 5 minutes. Thereafter, we will take questions from you, the audience, or should I say, participants. If you could please put your phones on silent, I would appreciate that. To keep time, I will make this sound to signal the end of the round. It's coming. And I hold it by the handle. There you go. There we go. Okay. End of the. Once you hear the sound, the speaker needs to bring their talk to a close. Gentlemen, Mr. Malema and Mr. Sunter, I want to see a clean debate. No biting remarks or vicious blows below the belt or unnecessary clinching. So without further ado, round number one, Mr. Sunter for 20 minutes.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and good evening, Mr. Malema. I'm going to turn this one off. Can we turn this one off? Yeah. So we don't get feedback. I'm really pleased. Oh my gosh. Okay, I'll go over to this side. I used to be in a rock band, so I know about feedback on the microphone. I did. I played with the Rolling Stones in 1964 at Oxford. Check it out on the internet. Anyway, I feel very privileged to be debating with Julius Malema because I watched on YouTube his speech at the Oxford Union, and I thought it was one of the best speeches I've heard by a South African politician overseas. Not using any notes. Just straight out, and then taking questions. And yes, I do have different views on how we can get our economy functioning, which I'll talk about tonight, but boy, you should watch that particular video. What I want to do is, what I normally do, is talk about the world and some of the flags that are changing the global economy, which are relevant to South Africa, and then I want to talk about the flags which people say we should watch in South Africa, and then give you the future possibilities for South Africa. I guess the first flag which is relevant for South Africa, we call the grey flag. It's the aging of the world's population, and the particular country that it's hitting at the moment is China. Because of the one-child policy in 1978, which they've now changed to a two-child policy, but that will only really click in terms of the economy in about 20 years' time. The Chinese economy was bound to slow down, and it is. And so this is a very tough time for the global economy, I think, and it's going to continue because China has been the major engine of growth for many years. The second flag that we talk about is the anti-establishment flag, which is the fury that not only the poor, but the middle class now have for the super rich. And a very good book was written 2 years ago by a French economist called Thomas Piketty, called Capital in the 21st Century, where he said that the level of inequality in places like Europe and America is back to where it was in 1910 through studying tax records. And he put it down to the fact that the return on capital in the stock markets and in property has, for the last 30 years, been much higher than the growth in salaries and wages. And this fury has really set the world alight. And when the middle class particularly get involved, that's when things change. I always say Karl Marx was middle class, and so was Friedrich Engels, and they produced the Communist Manifesto. And Robespierre, who was one of the initiators of the French Revolution was a lawyer. So when you get that combination of workers and the middle class beginning to feel that life is unfair, things change. And where do people start? Well, they start with the politicians. I was saying at the beginning of the last year that Jeremy Corbyn would have a very good chance of becoming the leader of the Labour Party in the UK. He's an old-fashioned socialist, and he made it against every sort of observer's expectations in the UK. Nicola Sturgeon in Scotland wiped Labour out because she also appealed to middle and working class people in Scotland. In America, right now, Bernie Sanders is running Hillary Clinton very close. In fact, in the young age group up to 25, in the two caucuses that we've had so far, he's taken 80% of the vote, 80% of the young vote of Democratic voters. So there is this real feeling that life is unfair at the moment and that we have to do something about it. And of course, I know that Mr. Malema will be saying something about that during his presentation. I just wanted to draw people's attention to the fact that it's actually driving society in the rest of the world too. The third flag, sadly, is around climate change, the green flag. It went up quite a long time ago, and there are still a lot of people who do not believe that climate change is really happening, but it is. Firstly, temperatures are rising. Secondly, sea levels are expected to rise by up to half a meter in the next 50 years. And thirdly, we're seeing more severe weather events, whether it's floods or whether it is serious droughts. And right now in South Africa, we have really serious drought. And unfortunately, it is making farming in this country a very tough game. So those kind of global flags are impinging on South Africa, particularly the one which relates to the slowdown of the global economy. What can make it recover very quickly is some new technology. And if you ask me to bet on what the next technological wave is going to be after computers, it's probably going to be around smart energy systems and smart water management systems. That is probably going to be the next big thing in the world. But for the time being, it's a pretty tough global economy, and we've got to make our way in that economy because we don't control those factors. So what are the flags that the CEOs in South Africa, for whom Chantal Ilbury and I facilitate sessions at their companies, say we should watch for? Number one, corruption. And yeah, I think Mr. Malema has certainly put that on the table in this country. And I have to say that for many companies, it's regarded as a real game changer. So the sooner we get to a clean, effective, moral society, the better. The second flag that they raise is around quality of infrastructure and the fact that you cannot grow the economy at 3 to 5% per annum if you don't have a sound infrastructure. Ports, roads, electricity, but also the invisible things like education and health. You've got to have a sound infrastructure in this country. I have to say, I think there's a green flag there with Eskom. I think the spirit is getting back into the business. I think their two major projects, Medupi and Kasili, are now back on track. But there are other parts of the country where people are expressing their anxiety. One CEO said the other day that in parts of the country, you don't drive on the left of the road, you drive on what's left of the road. And yeah, whatever the difference in ideology between Mr. Malema and myself, we have to tackle the infrastructure of this country. The fourth flag people talk about is a green flag. It's the pockets of excellence we have in South Africa. There are lots of pockets of excellence. And when you kind of get gloomy about this country, you've got to think about your daily life and how you come into contact with many companies that provide you with a world-class experience. Here in Cape Town, you've got the waterfront, which provides you with a world-class experience. But the critical thing about this flag is that we've got to replicate those pockets of excellence. It's like stars in a soccer team. You want to win the league, you've got to actually have those stars, and in the case of the economy, it's our pockets of excellence. We have 28,000 schools in this country, of which 5,000 are reasonable to excellent, and 23,000 are dysfunctional to shocking. How are we going to use the good schools to raise the performance of the bad schools rather than dumb the good schools down? Very critical flag. But it's the last flag which, for me, is the one about economic freedom. It's what I call the entrepreneurial flag, because one of the really big things that have changed in the world is the nature of work. When I was Mr. Malema's age, which was in the last century, work was created in big organizations with big factories, big plants, huge numbers of people working on mines. But unfortunately, that has changed. And it's because mechanization has driven a lot of jobs out of the system. And secondly, we have seen the employment model actually changing away from permanent to contract labor. So you want to create 5 million jobs in this country, you've got to create 1 million new businesses. It's not going to be done in big business. It's going to be done because we make the playing field level in this country. And we don't have that at the moment. We have a highly exclusive economy. We have one of the highest Gini coefficients in the world. And we haven't really given the true entrepreneurs, and Mr. Malema referred to that in his Oxford Union address, the guys who really create wealth. We haven't given them the support or the freedom to really open their businesses. We have a highly siloed economy, and we've got to do something about it. Personally, I feel we've got to have a requirement that every big business has 20% of its supply chain devoted to nurturing a new generation of entrepreneurs. Secondly, a big statistic went up the other day that Uber is now in the top 20 employers in Australia. And the Uber model is completely different to a normal big business model. It's where people are entrepreneurs for themselves, but they're connected together in a smart network. So is Airbnb, where people rent out their homes. But a lot of poor people in this country simply haven't got those assets. So we've got to think creatively of how we can use these smart networks to allow small business people to flourish. The third thing, I believe, is that we've got to have virtual stock exchanges in every city where you can advertise your business like eBay. It's a sort of dragon's den on the internet, and you can then seek capital from people on the internet, and they can go and see your business because it's around the city. But most of all, I believe that we should be identifying in every township economy the top 1,000 entrepreneurs in that economy and saying to them, this is what we're going to do so that you can extend your business into the mainstream economy of Cape Town, Durban, Port Elizabeth, Johannesburg, wherever, because we still have economic apartheid. We've got rid of political apartheid, but we haven't got rid of economic apartheid. But I do believe that we have to focus on small business because the nature of work has changed. So what are the scenarios for South Africa? Well, I'm going to quote you the ones from the Institute of Risk Management, who have just issued a report. And I facilitated a workshop for them last year, and they came up with brilliant scenarios. On the one axis, they had the global economy and whether it's stable and recovering, or whether it is in fact in a very unstable, risky state. And if you heard what I was saying earlier, I would say we're on the lower part of that axis because of China, and there's nobody at the moment who is replacing China. The second axis is, are we going to build a resilient economy, or are we going to have an economy that is vulnerable to local and to overseas events? And that gives you four possible scenarios for South Africa. If the world is in a recovery mode, the really good scenario is called Sunny Summit. And the great thing about that title is you don't get there without work. You've got to do a lot of work to get to the summit of Everest and look out at the view. And you've got to have teamwork. So it is very important that you have leadership that actually unites South Africa into a united team. I mean, think about it. When Alex Ferguson was running Manchester United, it was united. And they won the trophies. Then he left. So, yeah. You got to be united to get to the top of the mountain. The second scenario is called missed window. It's where the sky is blue, but we miss the window because we don't get our economy right. Now, I don't believe that those two scenarios have a high probability because the world recovery is, at the moment, not there. So what are the two scenarios if we're in a weak global economy? Well, the one is called steep climb. And it shows that you've got to have the skills, you've got to have the teamwork, and you've got to have the work ethic to actually make it up the mountain when the global economy is in pretty bad shape. And we've got to have a debate around the tactics to do that. The last scenario is where we don't get our act together, and it's called avalanche. Avalanche. It's either triggered by ourselves, or it's triggered by something overseas. And the kind of thing you should watch for the avalanche is the rand. If the rand is declared a junk currency, and just remember, we're two notches above that, you know, if we are declared a junk currency, then a cappuccino in London will cost you 1,000 rand. But I have just received the renewal of my car insurance. And it is the first time in my entire lifetime where my car is valued at more than it was last year. That's a flag. That is a flag. So we have to do everything to avoid the avalanche scenario. And I guess the difference between me and Mr. Malema is that I don't think nationalization of our assets will actually get us there. We can argue about the benefits of doing that. What will really get us there will be creating these 1 million new businesses of real entrepreneurs creating real wealth. So, that is all I have to say, and my debating partner, may the fox be with you. Thank you.
Okay, well, that was within time with the round, so we never had to save you with a bell. Mr. Sunter, you can make yourself comfortable on the stage. Mr. Malema, I think if you use this mic, probably be a bit better.
Thank you very much, the leadership of the chamber. and the leadership of the EFF. We have a deputy president of the EFF here, and the national. You are not recognized. We have our national chairperson here and members of parliament from the Economic Freedom Fighters. Well, I thought I was not going to say anything until you said there is a difference between us, because as you were coming, Mr. Santa, I was very happy that we are almost there. We're finding each other, but I realize, no, your understanding of economic freedom, it's a completely different from ours, because yours, it's a promotion of free market and neoliberal policies, and we are giving economic freedom the leftist radical interpretation, which means, amongst others, that the land, the banks, the natural resources, and strategic sectors of the economy should be in the hands of the people. We agree that we need to create an equality in this country, but that equality is not going to be achieved until there is a decisive state intervention. Because those who are at an advanced stage are beneficiaries of a state that protected them, are beneficiaries of a state that gave them opportunities to the exclusion of black people. And therefore, to create an impression that black people should make it on their own without state intervention, it's unrealistic and unacceptable. The state must take a deliberate decision to nationalize the land and distribute it for equal use for everyone. The state has passed a law in this country that willing buyer, willing seller. Even if people want to buy the land, if there is no willing seller, we'll never own a piece of land. It doesn't matter how much money we get from wherever, God knows, and then we come here and say we want to buy a piece of land in Stellenbosch. If there is no willing seller, we'll not buy that land. Therefore, even when we have money, we'll still not own a piece of land in our own country. So we have to get a situation where the land is owned by the state and is given to all of us, black and white. Because 80% of land owners in this country are white people. Yet 80% of the population is black people. It's unacceptable. We have to have this debate, and that's why you call us controversial and all sorts of names, because you are refusing to listen to the truth. And anyone who speaks the truth is an unacceptable person in society. And we're not saying this truth in a violent way. We're saying it openly in a frank manner. 80% of the, almost 10% of the population owns the land. And without the land, we are nothing. That's why what followed 1652 was land dispossession. Because you knew that with the land, you have everything. You've got mineral resources, you've got natural resources, and you can do anything. So we remain a conquered nation. We remain a conquered nation. And like you said in 1987, Mr. Santa, that negotiations must go on, parties must talk, and then thereafter, business must continue. Business is continuing as you predicted in 1987. Exactly what you said. Apartheid economy is still continuing. Because when you went to the table, when business negotiated with the former liberation movement, you made certain things very clear. You were not prepared to surrender the land. You were not prepared to surrender the economy. You told them you can have a black president, but you are not going to do anything with our property ownership. When the liberation started in South Africa, it was not about voting. Voting was by the way. The formation of liberation movements followed the wars of dispossession. And Africans realized that if we fight as small groups, we get defeated. We need to come together and fight together under a progressive body. Fight for what? For reclaiming of our land. So you can't tell us we gave you 1994, that's enough. That's not what we formed the liberation for. We formed the liberation to reclaim our land, to reclaim our wealth. The economy is the land. The economy is the mines and all mineral resources. The economy is the food. There's no food without the land. The economy is the banks, retail stores. We need the participation of our people in the technology and science, because we cannot succeed to fight even diseases that can be cured for as long as our people do not own pharmaceutical companies. The diseases that must be cured easily kill our people, because pharmaceutical companies are owned by capital which is obsessed with maximizing profit at the expense of people. So we don't subscribe to those types of... All of this infrastructure, me and you must agree about, which we are agreeing, will never be realized, because it has been proven that taxes alone cannot raise sufficient capital for the state. We have been collecting taxes since 1994. We still have a problem of infrastructural development because the money is not enough. We said to capital, run the economy, take charge of the economy, and through you paying taxes, then we'll be able as a state to develop this country. The same capital which we said run the economy still is not paying tax. They engage in financial illicit flows. They engage in aggressive tax avoidance in the country. No decisive legislation to deal with that. People take money in South Africa and invest it in tax havens. They are untouchable. If you do anything to them that is an interference, the state must not interfere. People, the investors will leave the country if the state goes on interfering in the economy. So we do not agree. We have this problem. We have this problem we are having today of an inequality which is growing, which is racially based, because of the economy which is in the hands of capital. The economy is not in the hands of the state as we speak now. It's in your hands. You are the ones who are owning strategic sectors of the economy. And therefore, if anything that is in the hands of private sector is so excellent and successful, why is Africa not successful? Because the economy of Africa is not in the hands of socialist state or communist state. It's private owned. If capitalism worked for America and Europe, capitalism has not worked for Africa. Africa has not failed because of communist or socialist economic policies. It failed because the multinational and capitalist come and milk our resources, exploit our resources, and leave this continent without anything. So we do not agree. So a solution, which is very clear in the hands of the EFF, is that we need the expropriation of land without compensation. And people say that is extreme, that is unacceptable. Land was taken through black genocide. We're not talking white genocide. We're talking legislation passed through parliament, democratic parliament, which will say the state is the owner of the land, and the land shall be allocated to people who have indicated clearly what they want to do with this land, and whether what they want to do, it is in the public interest and purpose. Because there are a lot of pieces of land all over the continent, they are idling. Some of them are even foreign owned. Yet black people live in congested environments. They do not own a piece of land. When they try to occupy the land next to them, no, that land has been rezoned, is owned by some fellow in London. We live like pigs in Alexander, in Langa, here, everywhere else. We have no land. And that is the first thing we need to do, expropriate the land so that we bring back the dignity of our people. There is no one who can have dignity and confidence if you do not own a piece of property. You remain a subject of those who own the means of production. We are tired of being subjects. We want to own. So we are of a view that even the mines, the banks, must be in the state ownership. But what do you do in a South African economy where already these things are in the hands of capital? You must establish your own bank as a state to compete the existing banks. You must establish your own state-owned mining company. You must establish your own pharmaceutical company. So we end by doing that. We do not shut down private ownership. The private ownership must coexist with state ownership, but the state must be the owner and the controller of such strategic sectors of the economy. Somebody is going to shout from the back and say the state is incompetent, and everywhere else where the state is found, things do not run properly. It's not true. It's not true. I'm prepared to take you on, because American Army is not private owned. It's a state owned. It's the biggest employer in the whole world. American Army is the one of the best state-owned companies. This GPS you are talking about is a GPS that is produced by a state-owned company called American Army. This internet you have is produced by a state-owned company called American Army. So we must not be misled that everything else state-owned is inherently corrupt, and therefore it will collapse. Even the private sector has got the same problem. The private sector, if we go to Joburg High Court here, there are private companies being liquidated every day. So it's not true that everything else owned by private sector is inherently progressive. We all have weaknesses. Yes, come back home. SAA, who said SAA never produced profit before? The SAA produced profit before until the current government messed it up. So it's not because the SAA as a state-owned company is inherently incompetent. You need a corrupt-free government which will deploy the best men and women for the job to run state institutions, and not to deploy friends. This ESCOM you are talking about, it ran properly at some point. And what is good about the whole thing is that there are some lessons we can learn from apartheid, because these things were state-owned under apartheid. They were state-owned under apartheid. They did well under apartheid, but for the few. So we have to learn and say, instead of deploying cadres and party loyalists, let us get the best people to come and do the job. Now, we have a situation in a country where most of the state-run institutions did well before, And as a result of the current corrupt leadership, they are collapsing. They are collapsing, and therefore, we must not say because there is an incapable leadership, state institutions will inherently not do well. I mean, we can give many examples. Singapore is one of the countries with state-owned enterprises which are contributing decisively to the economy. So we're saying here in South Africa, anything that is going to help us, it is a state intervention in partnership with private sector to run a successful economy. Anyway, as you were shouting at the back, I was not shocked because I don't raise comfortable things. I must touch the nerve. And I don't get easily shaken, whether by sober or half sober people. I have no problem at all. No one get to scare me. I express myself anywhere free without any fear or any intention of begging relationships. I'm here to articulate the EFF policy. You like it or not, it doesn't matter. We are happy that the Cape Chamber invited us, not because we share anything, but because we can exchange ideas. What is going to make South Africa work? What is going to make South Africa work is platforms like this, where we sit together and exchange ideas, sometimes in a robust manner, because it is good for our democracy. We cannot just sit in our comfort zones and not talk to each other. We have to talk to one another, sometimes uncomfortable as it might be. It's a necessary discourse because it will build this country. That's Madiba's legacy, the ability to talk to those you even disagree with. That's where we come from, and we believe that with this type of intervention, South Africa will be a better place. We have noted all those international developments, and even when it was nice time internationally, we were still doing bad, not because of the global economy, but because of the policies which were agreed to during the sunset clauses. We need the sunrise clauses. Thank you.
Mr. Sunter and Mr. Malema, thank you so much for your contribution. We didn't recognize some of those points of order that were thrown out. If we could give the speakers time to respond to the questions, what I will do is I'll take a roving mic and we'll put some questions to the floor and we'll alternate one for Mr. Sunter and one for Mr. Malema. Okay, are there any questions out here? I've got some at the back. Here we go. Was there someone up here? Here we go.
My name's Keith Scott. This is a question for Mr. Malema. I'd just like to ask him, he did say he was going to nationalize cannabis at one stage, and that's apropos of my question. This stuff, alcohol, contributes, I think, between 15 and 20% in taxes every year to this economy. And we're not going to ban alcohol anytime soon. But we do have other drugs like cannabis, which are far safer than alcohol, as are many of the other banned drugs. And I want to know Mr. Malema's view on the possibility of legalizing many of those drugs for recreational use because they are far safer than alcohol. I'm a medical doctor and I know these things. I'm a proponent of legal regulation of drugs. And on the other hand, where we have that huge amount of money from alcohol, contributing to the fiscus every year. We could have the same thing with cannabis and other drugs without the devastating effect on addicts and other people involved in the trade, which is basically a racial trade as well. It's the laws are founded in racist ideas. And on the, it'll also save a huge amount in law enforcement, because at the moment we get nothing from the sale of drugs, which is an enormous problem. It's a huge industry, and we still have to pay for the law enforcement. So I'd like to hear Mr. Malema's opinion. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Mr. Malema, if you'd care to answer that question.
Oh, I thought we're taking a...
I'll take a few questions.
Yeah.
Anything for Mr. Sunter?
Mr. Sunter, Richard Gee. I would have liked to pose this to Julius Malema, but I'll pose it to you, and maybe he can have a comment as well. The best people for the job, does that include BEE type rules and regulations? What do you see BEE as the future?
Thank you for that question. Would you gentlemen like to answer it now or wait for another round of questions? Here we go.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Oh. Good evening, everyone. My name is Marcia Mayaba. I've got a question for Mr. Clem Sunter. Mr. Sunter, I work in the motor industry with many first black female moments. And I was appointed for one of the automotive brands as a first black female dealer principal 5 years ago. I'm now talking a different language. I would like to own my own dealership. And it seems like I'm now suddenly speaking French. Because as far as the BEE codes go, they are still trying to tick the boxes at level 4, 3, and 2. I'm talking ownership, and it seems like I'm just knocking on doors and nothing is happening. And for me, I don't understand. The elephant in the room, it's which brand would not want to go into partnership with me in the sense that I'm an experienced black female with a solid track record in the industry for over 19 years, but nobody's picking me, and I'm talking about the top 10 major automotive brands in the country. Thank you.
Sorry, one more question for Mr. Malema, and then we skipped a section where we will allow Mr. Sunter and Mr. Malema 5 minutes each. Just to comment on their specific talk.
Good evening, Mr. Malema. It's Simon Christie. I'm very interested when you talk about we and they. We're roughly the same age. I was 12 when Madiba was released from prison, and I was 14 when the election happened. I'm a medical doctor. I work sometimes 160-hour weeks. I work sometime 18 hours a day, and I own property because of that reason. And it sounds to me that you're suggesting that I should do all that work and come to this point in my life and now just hand away my property. And that concerns me.
Thank you very much for those questions. Gentlemen, would you like to do your 5 minute rebuttal first, or would you like to answer the questions?
I'm happy to answer at least one of the questions, which is...
Okay. Mr. Sunter, you can go ahead.
I would like to really sympathize over this question of big business dominating with their brands. We are probably the most overmalled country in the world. You know, you have the same brands in every mall. And I'm not saying that you should damage them because, as I said, we have pockets of excellence. But we've got to realize that we don't have that kind of entrepreneurial energy that you see in places like Lagos, that you see in Hong Kong, that you see in Istanbul, because we haven't structured our economy for really good male and female entrepreneurs to open up businesses. We have to accept that, as Mr. Malema said, we have a problem with the land and the ownership of land, and we've got to jointly find a way out of that problem. But secondly, we have got to think of ways of really opening up our economy. And by that, I mean really opening it up. And that's why I've been calling for the last few years for an economic CODESA, similar to the political Kodesses, because this is a much bigger problem, because this affects everybody's daily life. They exercise the vote every so often, but you have to live every day in the economy, and therefore I totally sympathize with the point made by the lady, and I feel very strongly that we have to think of ways of creating a proper relationship between big business and small business, which is entirely different to what we have today.
Thank you.
Well, on the issue of the drugs, we agree that there are some of them which can be considered for use, others for medical purpose, and others for some of the reasons you have advanced. Because I'm not a doctor, but I'm made aware that most of the Western medication we take has got a bit of alcohol, and that alcohol is regulated. So it, and even people who don't take alcohol ordinarily, they end up taking that alcohol through that medication because it's properly regulated. The same thing should apply to any drug which we discovered that this can be used, it cannot be dangerous, but it has to be regulated, so that it doesn't become a danger in society. Like marijuana, we may have to decide how we're going to go about it and ensure that it doesn't become a danger in society. And it can go a long way in creating as well opportunities for our people, and also contributing to the fiscus, because people are selling it now, and the state doesn't benefit anything out of it. So if it's properly regulated, I agree we can find something. You know, you are an exceptional case. If you were to stand up and say, I went to school and I'm a medical doctor, and the property I have is because I went to school and I bought it. But most of your people didn't buy any property, they inherited it. So it's an exceptional case. No, you can disagree, but the reality is that you are in possession of a land that was stolen from us. And we want it back without any apology. We want that land back, and we are going to work together. I can tell you now, whether you are in denial or not, the demand for the land is growing and people are becoming impatient. And we don't want Zimbabwe here. We don't want Zimbabwe in this country. It has to be done legally, procedurally, in a manner that is not going to put the country and the economy in a disaster. We have to talk about it. We have to say, how do we, in a proper manner, make sure that everyone benefits from this land? So, you know, Mr. Santa will know, and those who were involved in the negotiations and pre-negotiations, that when it was inevitable for democracy to be ushered in, most of the corrupt state officials began to transfer land into the names of individuals. When we're building a road in Northwest, expanding a road in Northwest from Rustenburg to Mafikeng, the state had to now get into some farms so that, because they didn't have land reserves, so they had to go and take some portions of land as they go along, and then made a call. All those who were affected by our expropriation of land, please come forward so that we can compensate you. Very few people turned up. And the suspicion is that they do not have title deeds. People just declared, this is my land, just before 1994. So don't individualize a big problem. It's like when I say there is racism in this country and you come to me, but I'm not a racist. I'm not talking about you. If you are not racist, why are you worried? But generally, there is a problem of racism. It's not about an individual. It's a group problem. It is an institutionalized problem. We have to deal with it. And if we don't talk about it, we will not recognize it as a problem. And because we have not recognized it as a problem, now we will not be in a position to solve that problem. You can't solve the problems which you have not identified. So let us not be sensitive. I mean, you are a graduate. You are a doctor. You own a piece of property. I've got a black doctor here with me, very young also, a graduate, and he owns property. We're not taking your property only. We're talking also his property, the flat he owns. His flat is almost the size of your bathroom for sure. But even that, we're taking from him. So it's not about a black or white. All of us, we need to surrender our land to the state and give that state an opportunity to allocate it for proper use. You can shake your hand, I'm proposing a peaceful solution. You're refusing it, you will surrender it to the revolution.
Thank you very much, Mr. Malema. Mr. Malema has had his 5 minutes. Mr. Sunter, would you counter that, please?
Okay, I just want to say... Okay. I just want to say that in the end, as Mr. Malema has said, there is a balance between the private and the public sectors, and I totally understand the emotion about the land, and I do think it's got to be negotiated because it's not a simple issue. It's because it is a highly emotional issue, but we can differ on that one. What I want to say is that in terms of communist and mixed economy, I can say that I think the biggest economic success of modern ages has been China. And yes, it's been run by the Chinese Communist Party. I actually was asked by that party to go to the Central Party School. That's the inner sanctum of the party. It's their leadership academy outside Beijing in April 2006 to have a discussion with them about how to look at the future. And what really came across to me at this school was the fact that Mao Zedong was really no longer the hero of the party. It was Deng Xiaoping. And the reason that it was Deng Xiaoping is because he said, I don't care if a cat is black or white as long as it catches mice. And that is the point. In the end, we've got to come to a practical solution, because you need that entrepreneurial drive, because much of the success of the Chinese economy has been around small private entrepreneurs as much as it has been around a well-run state. Russia, unfortunately, is the exact opposite. It has never really grown that private sector side, and so the Russian economy, yes, it has American and European sanctions because of the annexation of Crimea, but there is no way that Russia has been as successful as China. The other one, which Mr. Malema quoted in his speech at the Oxford Union, was around Cuba. And the fact is that Cuba, now that sanctions have been lifted with America, is beginning to really motor. And again, it's a combination of the state, but it's all those smart Cuban entrepreneurs who are beginning to do their own thing and start businesses and trade with America and get American tourists into Cuba. I'm afraid to say Venezuela is like Russia. It just simply hasn't nurtured that entrepreneurial spirit. So my plea to the economic freedom fighters is that you balance those two kinds of economic freedom. The one, which is around ownership and the state intervention to ensure fair ownership in this country, but the other side is around really taking the incredible talent we have here in South Africa and saying, how can we create that next generation of entrepreneurs? Because in the end, probably the person in the world that has most influenced all of us is Steve Jobs. He wasn't a politician. He was an entrepreneur. Thank you.
Well, the Cubans achieved what they have achieved without American intervention. The levels of literacy in Cuba happened under the American economic embargo and under the communist-led country. Cuba is highly educated. Actually, it is even producing doctors for capitalist countries like yourselves. You can't produce for doctors for yourselves. The Cubans are helping you. The life expectancy is longer than ours. The Cubans' health system is the best. Their education system is the best. So Cuba is one of the countries that did well under Fidel, because those are the indicators you use to judge success. Not this thing we have here in South Africa that success means very few families must be rich. The Oppenheimers, the Ruperts, and them. And then as long as we have such families rich and the rest of the country is swimming in a pool of poverty, and then you call that success, it can't be success. Success means the general population must be doing well in terms of quality of education, the quality of health, life expectancy. Here in South Africa, people die at an early age, especially black people, from diseases that we can cure. But because the health system is dysfunctional and medicine is expensive, we don't live for far too long. So it's extremely unacceptable that we have a situation we have. So I don't know. I think under this development between the Cubans and the Americans, Cuba will even perform much, much more better. The Chinese you are talking about, no, because they were under sanctions. Now, if the sanctions leave, and other people are free to do business with them, without being intimidated by America, then we are guaranteed that people who have done well under difficult conditions, they will do well when conditions are better. You were trading with China, the whole world, they were trading with China, even when China was under the communist leadership. China is experiencing problems now, but I'm happy that Mr. Santa points to China as one of the countries which were successful under a communist leadership. You know, so we know all those shortcomings and criticism of Mao Zedong, but those are personality cult types of politics. What is principle for me is that the Communist Party of China made China to be what it is today, and you cannot ignore China in the global economy. So I'm saying here at home, we're not proposing that there must be a complete shutdown of private capital. We want that mixed economy with the state being a leader in the economy. In Botswana here, De Beers, Mr. Santa will know better than me, gave the government of Botswana 51% in the diamond mines. 51%. When they come into South Africa, next door, they are refusing. We don't just want 51%. We want ownership and control because we can't trust capital. They will say they produce so many diamonds only to find that they're misleading us. They've produced more. So they are happy with Botswana because Botswana is just happy with ownership and not control. We cannot be happy just with ownership. We want control. My sister is speaking about black people who are involved in some of these companies. You know, I always see black people who call themselves executives, who call themselves owners of this and that, and in reality, it's not true. I don't know of a single black person who owns anything with control and influence, not even Patrice. Patrice will never help you with anything. He's so hopeless. He can't help you because he's not in control. They claim to be in control. They are not in control. They've surrendered their blackness and they are being remote controlled by white monopoly capital. So we want a genuine black ownership and you must be in control. That's what we are fighting for. We must not be shown some cosmetic black success. People who have agreed to be curtains. I don't know of a thing. Maybe I'm still to see that person. When we do the site visits, they bring black sisters and brothers to come and make presentations before parliament committees. And because this parliament now is different, it has got some questioning people. After presentation, we go in and we ask very difficult questions. Black managers and leaders can't answer because they are not in charge. But because they said parliament is coming today, it will be you who present this. And then they say, this is the most senior person in this company. Okay, what is a simple question. What is the turnover of this company? That one I will give to my colleague. And then I must celebrate that. I'm not going to celebrate that. I want, not even Cyril Ramaphosa is a genuine black success. Cyril Ramaphosa is a puppet of the Oppenheimers. They made him form the NUM after the commissioner said black unions must be allowed and they must have the power to negotiate with the employer. The NUM was sponsored by the Oppenheimers and Cyril was given that task to go and form it. Cyril was working in the legal office or some offices, not even underground, from the University of the North. Then from there, he was given the power to form NUM. From there, he was fronted everywhere. They wanted to impose him on Mandela as the deputy president of South Africa, and the ANC refused. That's how Thabo Mbeki became the deputy president, and Cyril Ramaphosa got demoralized and left the ANC. Cyril Ramaphosa, because of that anger, did not even attend Mandela's inauguration because the agenda he was representing got defeated. I want genuine black. And black is not implementation. It's about your thinking and your commitment to liberate black nation.
Sid, we've got a question at the back here. Sid, we've got a question at the back.
Hello. Hi. My question that I'd like to pose is to Mr. Malema. Mr. Malema, I've come tonight really to listen to what you have to say. And you said something which I think was very valuable right in the beginning. You said that for many years you've been talking, but we haven't been listening. And I've had to do some serious interrogation in the past couple of months as to whether it's true that even if one views oneself as someone who is a new South African who believes in equality, whether one can really say that you do listen. And I have to be honest and say that I cannot truthfully know what the black experience is like. And I would like to request from you to assist me and to show me what it would be like to truly listen. And how would you know you've been heard? That's my first question. My second question would be, if listening, how would listening then be a two-way street? Because I think that there are two parties that could contribute, and I would like to see a great South Africa for all its citizens. Thank you.
Can we take a second question?
Good evening, Mr. Malema. My name is Clive Skulls, and I would like to leave a few ideas with you. I quite agree with you, the whole concept that the minerals in this country belong to the people. Now, that's my first point. At the moment, we've got the reality on the ground. People that's prepared to put their lives on line, we either shot by security guards or rock falls, and they called Zama people. They go in the mines with all the odds against them. The mines had deserted to a large extent those days. Why can't you negotiate a settlement between business people to allow those people, because they are trained in mining, and instead of giving a job, let them be miners and let they form an association or whatever to go into those mines. They will give them the opportunity to be entrepreneurs. That's the first point. The second point you're mentioning is Stellenbosch and land ownership and that sort of thing. Now, I'm living in that area, and the land, about 90% between Stellenbosch and Somerset West, I don't know how many hectares, belongs to the government, to the Stellenbosch municipality. It's leased on a 99 years to the farmers, who's been farming there now for generations. Now, that's another thing. It's land that has already been developed. And those wine farmers there are ready to assist and to help and to come to an arrangement where they can train their own people and to become in charge, as you say. The other thing is this about land ownership. I don't know what the percentage is, but a large tract of lands belong to the tribal authorities in this country. Now, that's another issue. It comes a long way. And in the past, the old government was accused of divide and rule, to say, you're a Zulu, you're a Xhosa, you stay there, etc., etc. But now, lately, the government that you and I had a lot of criticism about is reinstituting that whole concept. And what I can hear and feel from people on the ground is there's a lot of dysfunctioning, and the people are almost, it's like landlords that exert their power over the people. Why can't we also look at that land where the people are there to develop them? And in Tsolo, for instance, and in Kazimbabu, there is an irrigation system that is built many years ago, which is lying fallow, which can be implemented. And I think that is something that we can do, because I'm a practical person, and you are a practical person. And that's the way to resolve what we sit and what we have at the moment. So we take what we've got, we change it. We legalize those miners. We don't call them criminals. I think that's a good idea. Anyway, that's all. Thank you very much.
Mr. Malema, would you want to answer that?
Thank you very much. Well, I thought the listening and the hearing may be better responded to by Mbuiseni there, who has been a lecturer for some time, so you will understand what process it takes to listen and hear. But I'm saying here that We are now beginning to talk to each other, and we are beginning to listen to one another. It is still a difficult thing, because the way we started in 1994, we started wrongly with some artificial reconciliation, where the victims were told to just forgive and let go. And in that way, people had a lot of anger bottled inside them. And now, since we are beginning to open up and talk, and we've got the ear of high institutions, I think that the conversation will then help us to find one another. Sometimes we just misunderstand each other even on matters that we should be agreeing because of attitude. Who's saying it? And can these people be trusted? And understand where we come from. I mean, we're led by serious crooks. So you suspect anything that is state-related because you are like, they are going to take everything for themselves. So even when we say, let the state own the land and distribute it amongst us, you are like, they are going to distribute it amongst their criminals, and there's going to be beneficiaries who are only politically connected. So we come from that background and we are scared of the unknown. But I think that listening and hearing each other and talking to each other will help us find a proper solution. The Zama-Zama thing, you are correct. It's like those things of fishing here in Cape Town. People are just called illegal fishing people. They must be arrested. And where is that fish? It's called abalone. People can fish that thing. They are going to be sentenced for a very long time if you are found in a position of that fish, a natural thing that belongs to the people, is given exclusive rights to some multinational company which sells that thing to China, and our people can benefit. There must be a way of, if we are worried that if it's not regulated, people are going to drown and all those type of things, then let's engage in a process of training them. Like the Zama-Zama people. The Zama-Zama people are ex-mine workers who are well experienced, who know everything about mining. Actually, they've been surviving for a very long time. So the small-scale mining must be opened and must be protected by the state. And then we must be obsessed with security and safety of those people. So when we discover them, we then say, okay, this is how we're going to teach you so that we don't have a lot of casualties, because they die, those people. They die. And they die not because they are reckless. They do not have the necessary tools. They don't have the necessary equipment to do those things of mining proper, so that they don't risk their lives. Most ghost towns, which used to be mining towns, are actually surviving today because of the so-called illegal mining. So we can make a very nice intervention there. We can make a nice intervention here in Cape Town in fishing, because people have interest there, but they are being harassed by police because they do not have fishing permits and all those type of things. So we need to train our people. 80% of land is privately white-owned land. Land Surveyor General confirms that. So there is no majority of land in the tribal authority. It's not true. It's not true. So we must agree that there must be a, if it's 80% is confirmed by such an office, then we have a problem. And we have to deal with that problem. Yes, and part of the conditions of leasing a land to a farmer will be that you are leased, this land is leased to you for 100 years on condition you are going to train people here, you are going to do the following and invest in the community as well. Because people have been farming, but there is no an intention to transfer skill. And that's why you confidently ask the question, unashamedly, you want the land, what are you going to do with it? Because you know that you have not transferred skills to our people. So we need to begin to transfer land to the workers. We need to transfer shares as well to the workers. We need to give the workers shares, because you were so ready to give shares to so-called BEE. And that BEE, you gave them shares because they are politically connected. You are participating in corruption yourself, because you are happy to say, I want a corrupt politician to be part in my business. If this person does not have a political connection, doesn't get a BEE deal. But the real people who are doing work there are your workers. The people who are making your company to be what it is, it's your workers. You don't want to give them that 15%, but you are prepared to give it to a stranger called Cyril Ramaphosa. What is his connection? He is from the ANC. He will protect you. When they come for you, that's how he got a deal in Marikana. He said to the London mine, I'm a former secretary general of the ANC. I'm this, I'm that. I'm well known. I can protect you. The strike came in London mine. He never protected them. No BEE partner will protect you against the angry masses. It is the masses themselves who will protect you and your business. Because those people are making that company to be what it is. I'm saying to all of you here, those workers who are working for you, they are your company. If you give them shares and stop calling them workers and you call them partners, and they know that if they slower production, it affects their 14th check, after their bonus check, there is another check coming called a dividend. They will work two times because they know the 14th check is going to come and it will make our lives much better. Instead of giving to politically connected individuals, give to your workers. Stop promoting corruption.
Thank you, Mr. Malema. Mr. Sunter, I see you are making some notes before we take our next question. You'd just like to comment.
Look, I know that we're supposed to be having a punch-up, but I want to say I totally agree with this last point that Julius Malema makes, which is that we, and it really bears out that question that was asked about BEE, which is that employee share ownership programs should be absolutely critical in any new dispensation we have, absolutely critical. But I've also been listening, apropos the question that was asked earlier, and I detect there's a certain hybrid nature in Mr. Malema, because he's beginning to understand capitalism, that you that you have to, spread ownership. You've got to spread ownership. If you want to make people productive, you've got to spread the ownership to them.
Thank you very much. We've got one more question here. If you can please keep your questions brief. If you can.
I'll try my best. My name is Suja. This has actually been posed to both you, Mr. Malema, and Mr. Sunter, and it would be great if I could get some sort of response regarding it. Mr. Malema, you have presented contradictory views, actually. If I've listened to you, I've tried for the last bit. You say, let's have land for the dignity of our people. But how about taking away the hard work of others and taking away their dignity? How does this move us forward as a nation? It just says, let's redistribute the land, but at the same time, let's get the best people on the job. It's not clear where you stand between those two issues. And what do you mean by us and you. And you do use the word you a lot. So it's interesting for me, listening to you, where I stand. Where do I stand in this you-ness that you're referring to? I listened to the State of the Nation address. And I listened to the State of the Nation address review this morning. And I cannot remember the presenter's name because I do not watch TV a lot, but for some reason I happened to be there. And he asked our president, and he used the quote from, I believe it's Winston Churchill, don't ask what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. And he asked him, sorry, who? Sorry, wrong one, John F. Kennedy. But that was for me a very important question. That's why I paused and I listened. He asked our president, what can you do or what do we do to inspire the people of our country to move forward? We are talking about a brand. There is no us and them here. We are all different. Trying to say that this is Indian and white and black and Chinese and so forth is not helping us move forward. It hasn't helped us. I want to know what our brand is collectively. What does come to mind is when former President Mbeki called, there was a whole brand awareness thing that goes around, I am African. That pulled on people's emotional strings. I'm not saying that's necessarily the right way of doing it, but what is it? What is our brand moving forward?
Thanks very much. Mr. Malema, would you like to answer that?
We've got another question at the back.
Shall we take the answer first from Mr. Malema on that, and then we'll get to the next question? I know we're running a bit over time. You're getting more value for your money. We'll take another question after Mr. Malema's response.
Well, I'm not asking anyone to do anything for me or my country. I'm doing it myself. So part of my contribution on what needs to be done to make this country a better place is what I said here, that if we take over, this is what we'll do. So I think that the memorized question of what you can do for your country and without asking people what they can do is not for me. I think you put it to a wrong person. I'm not asking anyone for anything. All I'm saying is that a progressive country is a country that will address the imbalances of the past. There is still you and us. There will never be us for as long as there is no equal ownership of this country. If you have arrived, it's good for you. It's good for you. But you and us refers to the owners of the means of production and those who supply their cheap labor to survive. Majority of our people are going through a lot. And I'm not going to be pretentious and say, it's not taking us forward, you and us. No, there's no us. There's no us. We are fighting to have us. As things stand now, and it's not Malema's problem, it's an apartheid colonialist problem. They divided us. They reserved jobs for you. They reserved economic opportunities for you. 1994 did not dismantle the legacy of colonialism and apartheid. That's why Mr. Santa says there is still an economic apartheid. So in apartheid means we are apart. There's them and us. Deny it. The reality is there's them and us. I want Santin and Alexander to be one thing. To be one thing. But there will never be one thing because Alexandra is for the blacks and Santin is for the white minority. The haves and the have-nots are subjected to that congestion in Alexander. So we will never address the issue of racial division if we do not agree and speak to the reality that we are divided because ownership It's racially divided. So I'm not taking any dignity away from anyone. My sister, you have a dignity. We also want our dignity back. We have no dignity. We walk like we are ashamed to be here. Especially now at night, we do not enjoy the streets of Cape Town. Because we know that we are made to feel like we do not belong here. As we walk, we are treated like we are suspects in our own country. So we are not going to be coming here and saying to you, we are nice, we are enjoying it. We are not enjoying anything. We are still subjects of an exploitation in this country. And exactly this attitude of denialism is the one that perpetuates apartheid. Economic apartheid we have is because you are in denial. No, there's... No, it's good. Emotions must be high because that's what truth does to people. It gets their emotions very high.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Santo, you want to respond to that? And then we've got a question at the back, and then we've got a question here.
Okay. Look, I just want to say, and I really want to say this, that a function like this shows the good side of South Africa. We're at least talking to each other, and it's a start. So, you know, just get used to that idea.
Thank you very much. Donovan, do you have a question at the back?
Yep. Chase. Atuwa Tama Kamske. It means, in my ancestral language, our struggle continues. Mr. Malema, you have no authority to talk about land ownership. The Khoisan is the only authentic voice that can talk about land. We were the first freedom fighters fighting the colonials when they came here 360 years ago. We were the first people of this nation. We were the first people of Southern Africa. And today we still face oppression. This country's history did not start in 1910 when the ANC was established. Nor did it start in 1994 when you went to a democratic dispensation. We lived here, and you, your ancestors and the white ancestors found us here. So we can only talk about land ownership as you found us here. The indigenous people of South Africa and Southern Africa needs to be restored. That was taken from them by the invaders. I thank you.
I'm not sure there was a question there. Is there was a statement? Would you like to answer?
Well, I think that you are extremely missing a point. Me and you are Africans. And this land you are referring to and the whole of Africa was one thing until the colonialist came to divide us. So you must never see yourself as being something different from what I am. Otherwise, you are inviting self-isolation. We, the black African majority and the Khoisan, were one thing. And we are the only ones who can speak with authority about the Africa, the continent of African majority. So don't take away, I'm not from Europe. My ancestors are not from Europe. This Africa belongs to Africans, and that's what the Khoisan are. Don't isolate yourself, my sister. This solidarity will help us to defeat colonialist and apartheid legacy.
Thank you very much. We've just got time for two more questions. I'm taking one question here and one question down there.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Vuyisa Qabaka. I've just got two quick questions from the CIC and Mr. Santa. First of all, Mr. Santa, I just want to fundamentally disagree with you around the ability of South Africans to start businesses. You made a couple of examples. And what I'm going to premise my question around is the whole point around economic infrastructure investment in townships in South Africa and the lack thereof in the last 20-odd years in South Africa. So I just want to ask you, what is your take around the inability of the current ruling party to invest in economic infrastructure to enable and unlock? Because again, poverty in South Africa sits in the townships of this country, and yet that's where we're not creating infrastructure for economic enablement. For the CIC, I just want to say that those who feel it know it in Cape Town. So I do agree with you around some of the sentiments you've already made. But specifically to ask you to comment around three core areas that you have not specifically spoken to. One is the economic CODESA that Mr. Santa speaks of. Your take on the economic CODESA in the context of what you've spoken about today around those who are enabled and who've had centuries old of enablement in the context of economic CODESA, the National Development Plan, and the context of what the EFF speaks to around the National Economic Development Plan, and lastly, the fictitious black middle class that we all speak about that is, again, fundamentally funded through state-owned infrastructure, whether it's government agencies, it's government companies, or it's government itself, that's creating this fictitious black middle class. I want to hear your comments around that.
Thank you very much.
On the question of entrepreneurs in the township, I have to say that we haven't really started trying to integrate some of the, and I would say there are some brilliant entrepreneurs in the township, but they haven't made it because we have made no attempt to integrate the township economies into the mainstream economy in this country. And that's why Mr. Malema was right that I talk about economic apartheid that we still have in South Africa. And we've got to break down those barriers because this is daily life. As I said, you vote every 5 years, but you live life daily in the economy, and we haven't done anything. And you're quite right. We haven't got the economic infrastructure, and it is, I don't know why. I'm not sure that it's lack of passion about what entrepreneurs can do. Because, as I said, if you look around the world, the people who change your lives are the ones that come up with new products, which, because of technology or whatever, assist us in living better. And I just want to make it so much easier so that those people, and there are plenty in South Africa, can actually have the confidence as well as the financial support and, of course, the open market and not actually be dominated by big businesses trying to make their prices cheaper and put them out of business. That's why I'm talking about an economic CODESA, because we simply can't go on like this because we are one of the most unequal societies in the world. And yeah, I don't think we've even started in terms of creating the proper economic infrastructure in the townships for entrepreneurs that can do business everywhere in South Africa.
Thanks. I think we are in agreement about the economic CODESA. We needed to discuss about the land and how that land can be transferred to all. We needed to also discuss the worker share schemes. We need the economic CODESA to also deal with localization. Lot of chain stores in the country. do not even buy local products. I mean, textile industry used to be something very big, especially here in Cape Town. But it's no longer that big because it has been undermined by cheap products which are brought into the country and sold by some of these chain stores. So how do we buy locally? How do we protect the local industries? And also, we need to discuss, Mr. Santa, about the minimum wage so that we close the wage gap, the apartheid wage gap, the minimum wage, and whether indeed through such intervention we will be in a position to help grow the economy. And the decisions of the economic CODESA, they have to be binding. They must bind, and then those are the decisions which will inform ultimately legislation and policy which is to be adopted by the state. So it is important that we have that a conversation. And I think we'll have that conversation because this is how it starts. It starts with us. And once we reach consensus through these types of engagement, then we say, how do we formalize this, some of this consensus that we are reaching through the continuous dialogue that we are having? But if we were to go to an economic CODESA when we are still far from each other, it will not be a very productive CODESA. We ought to genuinely liberate the mindset of our people and win them over so that they begin to appreciate that it is through genuine, legitimate economic freedom that our people will realize true freedom. The black middle class needs to be politically conscientized. And it needs to be politicized because sometimes they confuse being credit worthy with being rich. They do not know the difference. And that's where the banks want them to think that by affording to rent in the suburbs here, what is that expensive one there? Whatever the names. So once they qualify to rent, they think, no, I've arrived. Most of the black middle class found in the white suburbs do not own those properties. They rent them. So they are credit worthy. And being credit worthy means you are a slave of capital for the rest of your life. And you are not going to leave your children any legacy. People are inheriting farms here. Your children are not going to inherit anything because for the rest of your life, you have been renting properties. And the NDP is just a reputation of gear. And the NDP says very little about the land question. If you do not address the land question, you have not addressed the fundamentals. You are still playing. You had to confront the elephant in the room, and that elephant is land ownership.
Thank you very much. Mr. Santi, you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I'd like to say that the NDP, how many people have read the whole document? It's 400 pages on the internet. It was never summarized into something which, you know, could be for public consumption. We didn't have a video explaining it. We haven't had anything. So the last thing I would like to achieve out of an economic CODESA is a sort of NDP document, which ends up in no implementation because nobody really understands what the challenges are. You've got to have measurable outcomes. I have to say, and I've written about it, the one document which is very emotional and sets out stuff in one page is the Freedom Charter. It really does. And if you actually read it, it's a modern document. So I would love, you know, to start the economic cadessa by just handing everybody a copy of the Freedom Charter rather than the NDP.
Thank you very much. Folks, I know we've all got, there are so many questions, but we're running out of time. I'm taking one more question here.
Thank you, Marcus Pillay, Consulting Actuary. My first question is to Clem Sunter. I take your point about the need for entrepreneurs and we need microeconomic interventions in order to grow the economy. But I put it to you that no non-Western country has ever become a high-income country on the basis of that model. That is not what South Korea did. That is not what Japan did. And they are the only two successful examples of non-Western countries that become high-income countries. So my question to you is that model, although it's good, there's no actual evidence that this is going to work. For Mr. Malema, Comrade Julius, shall I say, my question to you, comrade, is this. I think the key issue is when you said you don't trust capital. You were talking about the diamond mines and De Beers, and you said you can't trust capital because they will understate the diamonds. I think the difficulty is that on the one hand, you don't trust capital, but on the other hand, you find yourself in a world dominated by global capitalism. And that the only way to succeed is to deal with global capitalism as it is, not as you would wish it to be. Those are the countries that have been successful. Nyerere tried to nationalize land, it didn't work. Ghana tried to nationalize land and communalize land, it didn't work. So what is the key issue that you have with capitalism, and what do we need to do to persuade you that in this country, with the right restrictions and regulations, and with an interventionist state, we can harness capital to turn us into the next South Korea?
Okay, I'll start with the first question that you asked, which is you're quite right to put forward South Korea, because it is what I would call a hybrid model between government and private enterprise, because South Korea is one of the very few countries that's made it into the Premier League of Nations with an income per head of around $30,000 per annum. And it's because they achieved the right balance. North Korea didn't, but South Korea did. And it's an excellent example of the kind of hybrid model that I'm striving to create, because I take a lot of the points that Mr. Malema has said tonight, but I do want to stress that you still need those business people who have creative ideas, and in a sense, I guess my vision about black ownership is that a lot of the black ownership are entrepreneurs running their own businesses, and yes, having employees share ownership schemes as well. I just want the two to go in parallel, because you're quite right, South Korea is an excellent example.
Thanks very much. Well, I appreciate the fact that capitalism dominates and runs the world. But that's not a justification enough for me to trust it, because its obsession is to maximize profit at all costs. Yes. It doesn't matter if that profit puts the lives of people at risk. They will go for it. Yes. So we want a system that will put people first and not profit. Yes. So we are into those types of politics. But you gave examples of countries that tried to nationalized the land and failed, and you came across as one of the well-informed person, and I know that you then deliberately decided not to speak about China, because China owns the land, and then it leases land to private sector, and it is the second largest economy today in the world. So it is not correct that if Nyerere tried it, and it failed, it will fail everywhere else. We look at what Nyerere tried and how he went about it and which are the areas that made him fail. And we learn from that and do not repeat such things here in South Africa. In as much as we do not trust capital, we do not wish capital away, all we're saying is that capital must subject itself to the leadership of government. Government must be a leader in the economy, in politics, in social aspects of our lives. In that way, we know that we are not driven by the interest of profit at all costs.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, we don't have time for any more questions. I just must thank our panelists, Mr. Clem Sunter and Mr. Julius Malema, for opening up and sharing their knowledge with us tonight. Thank you so much. And thank you to everybody who came here this evening. No one has left, and we've 45 minutes over time. So thank you so much. Mr. Sunter, Mr. Malema, all that remains is for me to give you a gift. Thank you so much. We'll serve dessert now, and please enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you, and good night.